Now that we've described the setup for a galvanic cell, we start to define how we calculate the voltage that can be generated by any pair of half reactions that might be used. So you've seen notations on batteries about how many volts are generated. For example, you've heard about the 9-volt battery. And so the volts are the units that we use as a measure of the voltage generated by a battery. That voltage is a measure of what's referred to as the electromotive force, abbreviated either as EMF, electromotive force, or simply just the letter E. And so this is the variable that we assign to batteries to describe how many volts are generated. And hopefully this term makes sense. We're describing the movement of electrons, right? So electromotive, and it's a description of really how much force is generated as electrons move from the anode to the cathode. This value is also sometimes referred to as the cell potential. So as we get into calculations, I will ask you to calculate the cell potential. We use the letter E as our variable for it, and then we use or we measure it in units of volts. So it's a lot of terms in here, but just to help describe where they come from and what they mean, hopefully this helps. And we use the term cell potential because we are literally measuring the electrical potential that's generated as electrons are pushed away from the anode, right? They leave the anode, and as they are being pulled toward the cathode. So it's literally a measure of potential as electrons are moving. To be able to calculate volts for a given galvanic cell or battery, we of course have to have a way to calibrate. So many, many years ago, the hydrogen half reaction was determined to be the standard hydrogen electrode, which is assigned the acronym SHE, so not a feminist thing, but standard hydrogen electrode. And hydrogen was agreed upon to be assigned a value of 0 volts. So as we look at the reduction of hydrogen, we have hydrogen ions gaining electrons to form hydrogen gas. Notice our reaction is balanced for atoms and charges here. And so scientists agreed that this would be assigned a value of 0 volts. Notice the notation we're using here. Because this is a reduction half reaction, we have the subscript red, and that stands specifically for reduction. Notice we also have our standard notation included here. Like we discussed in chapter 13, that standard notation is going to come into play again as we start to interpret values. So remember, standard measurements would require that we're at 25 degrees Celsius. Our solutions would be 1 molar. And if we have any gases, they are at 1 atmosphere of pressure. As an example of how the standard hydrogen electrode would be used, if I wanted to construct a galvanic cell where hydrogen is the anode, in other words, it's oxidized, and copper is the cathode or gets reduced, I have these 2 half reactions. So notice as my anode, I have my hydrogen half reaction, literally just reversed from the previous slide. And notice that I change my subscript here to ox for oxidation. So hydrogen got oxidized. And essentially what that means is that I had to reverse my equation from the previous screen to change it from reduction to oxidation. But notice it didn't change the value of my potential, still 0. In this example of a galvanic cell, copper is being reduced. So it is reacting in the cathode compartment, and it has a reduction potential of 0.337 volts. We can actually measure the reduction potential of copper because when we set it up in this galvanic cell, note this picture here, notice we have hydrogen ions in our anode. We have the copper half reaction in our cathode. Again, anode does not have to be on the left side. It just happens to be here. So that as this reaction is occurring, because hydrogen's potential is zero, all of the voltage that is measured is assigned specifically to the copper half reaction. So it's by using this method, pairing any given half reaction against hydrogen, that reduction potentials can be measured for all substances. Another note to describe what happens if we were to reverse a reaction. So for example, copper is our cathode in this galvanic cell. However, if I used a galvanic cell where copper was oxidized, I would first have to reverse my equation. So notice that as an anode or oxidation half reaction, it is completely reversed or flipped from my reduction half reaction. I have that written backwards. I apologize. I thought something looked odd. So as an anode, copper would have to be oxidized. So sorry about that typo. And notice the other change that's made. So the reduction potential for copper is a positive 0.337 volts. But once I flip my equation, I'm literally changing the direction of electron flow. When I change that direction of electron flow, I not only change my equation to oxidation, but notice that it changes the sign of my cell potential. And so anytime you need to change a reaction from anode to cathode or vice versa, you reverse the equation and then change the sign. As another example of how we use standard reduction potentials, this goes back to our first copper and silver galvanic cell that we used in our drawing. And notice here, because we know that copper is the anode in that reaction and that silver was our cathode, we can then write our oxidation and reduction potentials for these two reactions. So these are quantities that you can look up. We just have to determine the sign that would be used to denote the anode or the cathode. And then the easiest equation ever, hopefully. If I want to calculate my standard cell potential, so I'm using standard because we have the standard notation here. And then remember that E represents our cell potential. So if I want to calculate the standard cell potential for a given battery, my setup for that calculation is simply to add the reduction potential to the oxidation potential. So once I know what gets oxidized and what gets reduced, then I can simply add those two together, paying attention to the signs. Since we are adding, we're going to go by decimal places. The calculator spits out a 0.463. Because we're limited to two decimal places from our reduction potential, our final answer would be 0.46 volts. And so that is how we determine or calculate the voltage of a galvanic cell. And so here is the typed version of that same answer. What we need to build up to and figure out then is how do we tell which half reaction will be oxidized and which will be reduced? For this copper and silver example, I told you the reaction so we could tell. What we now look at is how we can use a species' ability to reduce another substance. In other words, as something acts as a reducing agent, we can determine what is more likely to be oxidized and what is more likely to be reduced. We'll get into detail on that in the next video, but just to help you start to understand what information we use, we will be using standard reduction potentials in this chapter. So Appendix L in the textbook uses or shows for a series of half reactions the standard reduction potential for given half reactions. Notice again, these are all listed as reduction half reactions. So at the start of our next video, we'll actually start with this slide again and then start to interpret as we combine half reactions, how do we determine what's oxidized and what is reduced in a galvanic cell.